What's up, everybody, and welcome to episode 96 of the ChumpCast. We waited 14 years for a follow-up to Brad Bird's Pixar masterpiece, The Incredibles, and it was well worth it. We also take some time to yell at each other about board games, Mark's inability to match socks, and redundantly telling someone that you're about to tell them something. We'll be seeing Chris Pratt and some dinosaurs in Jurassic World, Fallen Kingdom, next week. In honor of that, we want your submissions for the worst idea science has ever had in a film or in real life. Send us your thoughts on any social media platform at the ChumpCast. You can also call or text us at 847-920-6107. If you leave us a good enough voicemail, you might hear yourself on a future episode. If you want to support the show, you can find our merch at thechumpcast.com. We always appreciate kind reviews, subscriptions, and ratings on Apple Podcasts. You can also shop on Amazon through our affiliate link at thechumpcast.com/Amazon. Now, if you'll excuse me, I'm going to go not play Risk because I'm not a massive dork. All right, are you going to yell at me about Risk now?
Yeah, it's unacceptable that you have not played Risk.
You've just played every game of all time.
No, that's like a staple in the gaming community. It's Monopoly and then it's Risk. No.
Yeah, I'm not that deep into the gaming community.
That's two games deep into the gaming community. Everybody who's had a good childhood has played Risk.
No,
Stratego.
It's Monopoly, Sorry, Chutes and Ladders.
Mousetrap. Candyland.
Fuck Mousetrap.
I'm not saying they're good. I'm just saying everybody has them.
And they're better than Risk.
100%. Yeah, fuck you, prick.
That's a terrible take. It doesn't even matter. You're saying Mousetrap is better than Risk.
I don't know, because I've never played Risk. Your argument was that if you got 10 people in a room, 9 of them have played Risk, and I refuse to accept that, because there are 3 of us in this room, and 2 of us haven't played Risk.
2 of you guys are dumb idiots, including not myself.
Stratego is better than Risk, also. So
you've never played Risk.
Stratego is basically Risk, but way better than Risk.
You know who I bet loves Risk? Who? Chris Hardwick.
Yeah. That diddler. Yeah, fuck him, by the way. I don't know if it's true, but it's definitely true. Whatever came out in the media the other day about him being abusive, we can't confirm it's true, but it's for sure true, people. So
did you read the actual article she wrote? Blog post?
I read excerpts from it.
He
wasn't letting her go out, talk to any guys, stuff like that. Just really weird and psychotic kind of stuff. He wouldn't let her drink any alcohol while she was around him because he is sober and doesn't drink alcohol, which is great, but still, you don't need to push that upon the person you supposedly love. Like, okay.
Yeah, that's fucked, but let's go back to this game. What games have you played? If I have to ask, like, what games have you played?
A lot of them. I don't know.
Everything
you want a
full
running list of every fucking game I've ever played? I don't know.
I want to know the top 5 games that you've played, board games.
I remember playing the Jumanji board game and how bad it was and being so stoked because the movie was awesome.
Okay, yeah.
And I'm like, well, this game has to be cool too. And it was terrible.
You can't expect a game that sucks you into a different alternate dimension to be good just as a board game.
Maybe you can't.
No, you can't. Nobody can. So Jumanji, okay.
I don't know, dude. I don't have a full fucking list.
There's a spider. I'll fucking murder that spider for you. Hold on.
Drunk Erica just burst in the room because there's a spider.
This is not the first time. This isn't.
I'll use my bare hands, too.
For the record, Erica has played Risk, too. Just so she knew what it was.
Wow, you're up to 2 out of 4.
Yeah.
That's the same thing as 9 out of 10, right?
I'm blown.
I know I don't usually ask you to do math on the show, but...
Yeah, well, we still... I'm going to get...
Go ahead.
18
no.
other people.
What other games should I have played by your decree?
Risk.
I said, what other games?
I know. The only game you should have played is Risk. Everything else is whatever.
I think you're being a little ridiculous here.
No. Sorry is up there.
I play
Mark
Sorry.
Mark was on point with Sorry.
Guess Who? Does that count?
That's a good staple. Standard Monopoly, obviously.
Obviously.
Monopoly Deal, that's next level.
I've only played that because of you.
Exactly. But it's a good game. That doesn't count because I learned that in college. That doesn't...
Batman Flux?
Oh, yeah.
The game that we were obsessed with for a week?
It's right there. We should go back. We should play that again. That game was actually fun.
Did you kill the spider, Mark?
Spider-Man is dead. I'm just kidding. That would be abuse. So no, I let him outside. He's still alive.
Liar, you murdered him.
I was very gentle with him. He's actually still roaming around your house and Erica doesn't know.
You put it in her pillow?
Yeah.
Thank you for saving her life.
What did I miss?
Absolutely nothing.
Okay. Are we talking about board games still? Because Monopoly is great. Simpsons Monopoly is great. Chicago Monopoly is great. The Office Monopoly is great. There's a Rick and Morty Monopoly, I'm pretty sure. That would probably be great, too.
Wow, good story. Right. The point is, Risk is dumb and so are you.
That's fake news, everybody. Play Risk.
Talk into your microphone.
I know, I'm looking at this. I just got a text from my friend who, a random old guy at my Lake Zurich gym, LOL, wearing a Chumpcast shirt.
That's definitely somebody that bought one and, like, gave it to Goodwill. And they were like, ooh, Humpcast.
A random old guy was wearing that?
Yeah.
Lake Zurich gym. That's weird, because that's definitely the same guy Matt saw at the gym in Lake Zurich. I'm assuming they go to the same gym, but some guy is wearing a Chumpcast shirt. I have no idea who he is.
If it's a random old guy wearing a shirt, are we sure it's not Tofty?
Does he live in Lake Zurich?
I heard he's like big and bald.
Will?
Porter? No. He would not go to the Lake Zurich
back to the show.
Or the gym.
You were supposed to tell me what other games I should have played by now.
I was looking up board games.
Stratego. Clue.
Clue would be up there.
Obviously.
Battleship. Come on.
Yeah.
But Battleship's like lame. Battleship's like boring as shit. That's what I'm saying is there's not that many games out there. That's
Puck
why
in
you
your
should.
Fucking microphone, Jesus.
His face is like against the fucking pop filter, but it's facing the opposite direction.
God damn it.
Dude, you can get Monopoly deal for $5. That's a good deal. Yeah, dude, you got Sorry?
Risk sucks, dude.
Fuck you and Risk.
Chess. Greatest board game of all time.
Wait. Checkers.
Checkers?
Checkers is better than Risk.
You want to know something really fucked up? I don't know how to play checkers.
What?
I swear to God.
I'm sorry. Do you know how to play chess?
I know how to play chess.
And you don't know how to play checkers?
Yeah. That's how fucked up I am.
Talk about a taboo. That's another board game.
Boo.
That's another board game that I'd throw that. Life. Life is up there.
I always just love spinning the fucking life little dilly dally dialer thing.
Candyland.
Obviously, we already mentioned it.
See, there's not that many good board games from Hasbro specifically.
There's a game called Puerto Rico. What is that?
I'm not going to make an offensive joke
yeah,
here.
I'm not going to make any comments, but okay.
I thought that's why you looked directly at me.
I'm just going to say I'm very disappointed in both of you.
I don't care. You disappoint me on a weekly basis, so
shut
up. That's
not true. That I always exceed expectations.
All right, let's talk about our question from last week. In honor of seeing The Incredibles 2, the movie that we waited almost 15 years for, we asked you to send us your favorite quotes from superhero movies. And this is basically just an excuse for Mark to do his Joker impression.
Cue it.
I'm gonna give you one that you can do. I didn't pull up the YouTube video for it, so we don't have to listen to it. But Team Pacey on Instagram sent us one that I didn't even remember. And I'm guessing that neither of you do either.
The rest of us have one job. Tear these things apart. You get hurt, hurt them back. You get killed, walk it off.
Captain America, a perpetual badass.
Man, he's amazing. Right. You killed, walk it off. You Sally.
Not a great movie.
What?
Avengers Age of Ultron? Not great.
Comparatively to like Infinity Wars and stuff like that, but
it's better.
Yeah,
than
I mean, like
Risk.
If you put it on the Jumanji scale or something, it's awesome. But
I roll. Go ahead.
I'm just gonna needle you all fucking day.
Go ahead. What else is new? Next.
Engine 26 Studios. This one, I'm guessing this person is dating themselves a little bit. I don't know how old they are, but they're probably close to my age range.
I'm not going to kill you. I want you to do me a favor. I want you to tell all your friends about me.
What are you?
I'm Batman.
I have a counter argument to that.
I am vengeance. I am the knight. I am Batman.
Does murder that, so.
Yeah, and Keaton versus Conroy, I love them both, but I gotta give that to Conroy.
You have to.
All right, Mark, it's your time to shine. You fucking weirdo. First of all, start this out with a Joker. What's up, Darian?
What's up, dude?
All right, our guy Darian with the obvious layup.
I'm like a dog chasing cars. I wouldn't know what to do with one if I caught one. You know, I just do things.
I knew that you just got so excited for that. Is that the only reason you showed up today?
Yeah, just so I could read these in my Joker voice.
That and to argue about Risk?
Yeah.
I wish you would just talk in the Joker voice the entire podcast.
You know, Risk, it sucks dick.
Fuck you, Brick.
Next.
White Trash Betty, back in the mix, a.k.a. B-Daisy Speck on Instagram.
He may have been your father, boy, but he wasn't your daddy.
Yeah. Heartbreaking moment.
Yondu, yeah.
He's got some good quotes all around this hillbilly, racist, He's not racist. That's not fair. I shouldn't say that. I just think every time I see him, I think Walking Dead.
Yeah.
Well, so, Merle was racist.
Yeah, he's Blue Merle.
Yeah, he is Blue Merle.
He's got some great lines, though. That and I'm Mary Poppins, y'all.
Oh, I thought you were going to play it.
What?
You look like Mary Poppins.
Is he cool?
Hell yeah, he's cool.
I'm Mary Poppins, y'all.
Yes. Okay.
E-Games yes. 91. Our boy Eddie, with one of my all-time favorites, and may God rest his soul.
Soul is ready.
Yes.
God, I miss Macho Man.
Macho Man was
Randy
the man.
Savage.
Probably some of the greatest commercials, the Slim Jim Macho Man commercials.
Did they lead the way for weird-ass commercials?
I think so, because those were pretty much the start of some weird-ass fucking commercials back in the 90s.
I never really thought of that, but yeah. I think they did kick that off, and now it's just like status quo.
Snap it to a Slim Jim! Eat me!
Wow, right. You are staring off into the distance longingly.
I have to stare this way in order to talk into the mic, or else I get yelled at by some grump-ass grump. Next.
All right, do you guys have favorites?
I do.
Of course you do. Tell me why it's Christian Bale Batman.
It is.
Okay, unpopular
opinion. Not surprised at all.
I don't think that Batman is very quotable.
But what about when he says,
"Where the drugs going? Where the drugs going?"
That's not a good quote.
Where the drugs going?
Where are they?
Where the drugs? Where the drugs going?
Rental.
That was Harvey Dent,
he doesn't have good lines.
Where the drugs? Where the drugs going?
In that entire 3-movie set, he's got like one monologue where he talks about how he can be an icon. And other than that, he doesn't have shit. The villains and even the supporting characters. Harvey Dent has good quotes. He doesn't have shit.
The city just showed you. There's a lot of people ready to believe in good.
Yeah, that's not a good quote. I just cringed a little bit with you saying that.
Ready to believe in good.
And that's not to say that he did a bad job. It's just they didn't write him good dialogue.
I'm not wearing hockey pads.
There it is.
That's probably his best quote from those movies.
I'm not wearing hockey pads.
All right, Mark.
I got to keep practicing.
No,
I'm not wearing hockey pads.
Stop.
I'm not wearing hockey pads.
Mine's not good.
All right, Brick, what is your favorite quote?
You have mine queued up?
You didn't tell me what it is, so.
I commented on there.
You didn't read my mind?
From the original Iron Man, when he reveals himself, stick to the cards. Stick to the cards.
Truth is, I am Iron Man.
There's a real long dramatic pause in there that I don't remember.
Yeah, that's amazing.
I don't really like that one because he doesn't say it with pride. It's not like he's happy to be Iron Man in that scene. He's just like...
No,
because
they were just telling him to cover up the whole thing. And he stumbles through the first part of the speech and then he just goes up and goes, the truth is. And then he's like, you know what? Fuck this. I am Iron Man.
Unlike Christian Bale, Batman, who just lets Harvey Dent take the fall. He's same exact scenario right there in front of press, people waiting for him to fucking... Everyone that knew he's Batman waiting for him to be like, I'm Batman. No, fucking Harvey Dent comes up and just takes the bullet for
him. You know, that's why Iron Man actually won Movie of the Year over Dark Knight.
No, it didn't. When did Iron Man come out?
Same year.
2008.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Is that true?
That's very true.
No, it's not.
In your face. It is the same year. It was the same year.
Okay.
No, you lose.
I would argue that's not Tony Stark's best line.
It's not, but I still think that's just one that stood out to me that I was like, that's amazing.
My favorite Tony Stark line is...
Big man in a suit of armor. Take that off. What are you?
Genius, billionaire, playboy, philanthropist.
Just slam dunked on him.
Yeah.
All right.
He alley-ooped himself and then did a windmill and then just fucking Vince Carter elbow deep dunked over Captain America with that one.
The honey dip or whatever, honey jar dip or whatever. Yep. Yeah, I know what you're talking about. All right. So can you actually play my favorite quote? My favorite quote.
I don't know what your favorite quote is.
Henry Cavill Superman when he snaps Zod's neck when he's just screaming. Can you just play that right
terrible.
Now? Can you play
no,
that?
No, I refuse
just
to.
Just play
no.
it. Play it.
I refuse to give that any recognition.
No, play it.
The real best superhero quote of all time.
Hey, this is a 10. The tab's 13.
You're 2 minutes late, dude.
Ah, come on. I couldn't find a place.
Wise man say, forgiveness is divine, but never pay full price for late pizza.
I gotta get a new route.
I was thinking about Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
Just very quotable.
Are they superheroes, though? They're ninjas. Yeah.
They're based on Daredevil.
I guess. Yeah.
They're mutant turtles. How are they not superheroes?
I guess. Just play Zod getting his.
I'm not fucking playing that clip.
Come on.
No. All right, I can't get through this without mentioning one of the best quotes, one of the darkest quotes.
None of you seem to understand. I'm not locked in here with you. You're locked in here with me.
That's intense, and it's a direct quote from the comic.
Yeah.
So it's that was Rorschach is an all-time badass character.
Yeah, that was an incredibly badass scene right there.
First time I saw that, I remember getting goosebumps.
That was great. That was fun. Fantastic.
Yeah, there's going to be a lot of editing in there. That'll be fun.
That was incredible.
Enjoy the editing, you piece of shit. Grumpus.
I will kill your mic. All right, for next week, since we're reluctantly going to see Jurassic Park, do either of you really care?
I am not excited to see that movie at all.
I'm fucking jazzed about it, dude.
Are you?
Why?
Chris Pratt's the man.
Is that it?
Yeah, dinosaurs exploding on an island with a volcano. What's not to love?
I'm going to make a guess and say that we've already seen the best parts of this movie in trailers.
Them running off the island.
Do we have a question of the week?
That's literally what I was about to talk about.
I was thinking it could be like, what's the most rapey dinosaur from Jurassic Park?
Chris Hardwick?
Yeah, I guess. You could do that one.
Chris Hardwick.
Oh, man. We shouldn't joke about that, but
not,
it's funny.
Not until all the facts are out, but the facts are out for sure. He did it.
Innocent until proven guilty, but he's definitely guilty. Guilty. I can't talk today.
He's guilty?
He's guilty.
Figure your shit out, Smithers.
Him and Chance Vanderbleak.
He's guilty.
They're very guilty.
Chase Vanderbleak.
He's guilty of the diddling. He's guilty.
All right, next week, in honor of Jurassic World 2 Fallen Kingdom, we want to know what the worst idea science has ever had in a movie is. Obviously, bringing dinosaurs back is not a good fucking idea. By the way, did you see there was a news story this week that somebody was saying within the next 5 years we'll be able to clone dinosaurs? The tweet responses to it were like,
no,
there are five movies about why this is a terrible fucking idea. Have you never seen Jurassic Park? What the fuck are you doing?
I don't care if we can or can't, as long as once we do clone it, we have one guy with a big white beard and a stupid fucking Jurassic Park hat overseeing all this. What's his name?
I don't remember.
Let's really lean into the whole disaster thing, then.
Only if you put him on an island. And you start crossbreeding them.
Yeah.
The only way this is a good idea is if you can miniaturize them. And then basically you're just making lizards.
Mini dinos. Ooh.
All right. So we have an update on the guy who has the Chumpcast shirt in Lake Zurich.
Let's hear it.
He said a friend gave it to him by the name of George. He was Thorn. So some old Thorn guy.
What?
Chumpcast fan.
Wow.
Let's go.
What? I am endlessly fascinated by this.
Does he like the shirt, though? I'm sure it's an extremely comfy shirt. That's why he likes it.
I guess so. We've seen him multiple times wearing it. So.
Who the fuck is a foreign George with a shirt?
I have no idea. That's hilarious, though. All right. So anyways, for next week, send us your worst movie ideas. You can obviously find us on all social media at the ChumpCast, or you can call or text us at 847-920-6107. Thanks, guys. All right, guys, let's talk about some news. Mark, why is your boy James Wan being a dick?
Because it's what he won to do.
Oh, terrible. Okay, why? I'm totally leaving that in.
I'm out of here. Goodbye.
He's not releasing anything but still photos from Aquaman, even though they already showed the trailer at Cine Europe, at the conference in Europe. They did this for a few movies, and I don't understand this. Why didn't somebody have their phone out? What you do is you leak the shitty quality version, then you force Warner Brothers to release the actual trailer.
Like Suicide Squad.
Yeah,
I know. I was looking for a shitty iPhone video.
And nothing.
Here's the thing. We have some of the greatest cameras and video cameras on our phones now. But every time I feel like a trailer leaks on a video phone, it's just shitty ass quality. I'm like, what are you using to record these videos?
It's somebody sitting in the very, very corner
yeah.
in the front row filming in portrait mode.
Yeah. It's like, I'm going to use my LG flip phone to record this video right here.
My Motorola Razr.
This is going to get so many views on YouTube.
Yeah. Well, it probably would get a million views, but we did get some descriptions, and they say that it's not just traditional action and super over-the-top special effects, but there's also some humor, and it's not as dark as traditional DC movies, which would be great.
Finally, they're giving the people what they want.
Yeah, and Brick, I showed you, we had our first look at Wonder Woman's new costume from Wonder Woman 84. It's really bright.
It is. Also, I go by Brichetto now. I don't go by Brick anymore.
Why? Shut up. I think James Wan isn't releasing this because he's too busy talking about doing an Arachnophobia remake that no one wants.
Yeah.
That's a real thing?
Yeah.
So we're going to get this 100% at SDCC.
Yeah. He tweeted out yesterday and said it'll be at Comic-Con, which, fuck you, James Wan.
Yeah, thanks.
I've been tweeting him all week.
Thanks for letting us know, man. We fucking pretty much figured that.
Yeah, I've been saying that for a month. All right, question. Did Steve Trevor die in Wonder Woman?
Yes.
Then why is he on set as Steve Trevor
flashbacks
in the Wonder Woman sequel? No, he's dressed, it's clearly in the 80s.
Yeah, she's, and he looks older flashbacks too.
She's imagining him being there with her in the 80s.
So you think she's crazy?
Yes.
Or she's daydreaming. Or he's got a twin brother that they never knew it was a thing.
It would have to be like a twin grandson.
No. Oh, yeah. So that's just going to be him, his...
Well, that's what offspring. The original speculation was before we even saw Wonder Woman, is that in the sequel, Steve Trevor would just have a son. And
please tell me his name's Steve Trevor the second or the third.
No. Please tell
just
me.
Just his... really lean into it.
No, if his name was Trevor, that'd be fucking great. Trevor.
Just call him Trev Squared.
Yeah.
DC's trying to fuck this up, aren't they?
I don't know what they're going to do.
No.
They made one good movie, and now they're like, we can do whatever we want.
No. I think the one thing that was good about that Wonder Woman movie was the chemistry that Gal Gadot and Chris Pine had. And I think they needed more of that, because I really enjoyed that aspect of the movie. So I'm happy they're bringing him back.
Look, Chris Pine is great.
He's awesome. He's one of my favorite actors, honestly.
Why didn't they just not kill him? I guess he'd be really old, so that wouldn't work either.
That wouldn't work either, and I think he needed to die at the end of that movie. Wow, spoilers, I apologize. But he needed to die at the end of that movie to kind of bring the whole movie together.
I agree with you, but also, fuck you. Wrist sucks. Did either of you see either the Aeon Flux reboot movie with Charlize Theron?
No.
Or the original cartoon?
Nope.
Do you remember in the opening sequence, like, she catches a fly in her eyelashes? You guys have never seen this?
Nope.
God damn it, I'm so much older than both of you.
When did this movie come out?
And lamer.
This movie came out in like 2004. But the cartoon was mid-90s. Anyways, MTV is going to reboot it, and they're going to do a live-action version.
MTV?
It was on MTV. The cartoon was.
I didn't even... First of all, I failed to realize MTV even had a
creative
TV station.
Department.
I didn't even realize they had a TV station until they announced Jersey Shore was coming back. I didn't know what the fuck they were playing on there. Were they just doing reruns of Road Rules and all those
the challenge?
Shows? The Challenge.
Oh, they have like Teen Wolf on there.
Yeah,
and
that's
stuff?
That's what I was going to say. Is that the same people that made the Teen Wolf show are making this?
Wasn't that successful? Was that
people
successful?
People seem to like it. I thought you told me you watched it, but I guess not.
Not really. I miss TRL though, to be honest.
But Carson Daly.
Yeah.
Music videos are tight.
Yeah. Especially when it'd be like Sum 41 with Carson Daly, just like, stomping through the party, my name is Lee.
This is probably just me.
That's a great song, by the way.
Yeah.
If you guys are at a bar and they're playing music videos, do you ever find yourself just watching the music video and ignoring everybody
100%.
Around you?
Especially when I'm with you, yeah.
100%.
That's fair. I don't know where I was going with that.
No, that's cool, though. I didn't know MTV was actually doing things with their lives, so good for them.
They have like a billion episodes of Teen Mom on.
I was about to bring up
Teen
Mom.
Dog in the can, yeah.
Don't get me started on that fucking show.
Erica watches that garbage.
Kelly records that garbage on her DVR, and it restricts my shows from getting recorded because
she deleted Teen Titans Go to make room for Teen Mom.
No, seriously, she like has it where it records even the reruns. So we have like 14 hours of fucking Teen Mom recording, and I just lose it because I look at our DVR and it's fucking only Teen Mom. I'm like, how are you fucking even just putting this much shit into your brain right now?
You can't have that many hours of Teen
Mom. I
gotta
be honest. One of my favorite things about doing this show is just getting Mark started on a rant and sitting back and watching it.
Oh my God. Should I do my own podcast? Just my fucking rants about life.
It's what Bill Burr does.
Yeah.
Bill Burr's a psychopath.
Speaking of that, I haven't listened to a Bill Burr podcast in a while. He did one the other day when he was actually in France. He was just talking about baguettes and dumb shit and just ranting about the most ridiculous shit. By the way, go check out that podcast if you've never listened.
He's so angry.
He's so funny, man.
It's great.
Very angry, man.
All right. Speaking of cartoons coming back, Looney Tunes is coming back, but in a different kind of way. We're going to see initially 1,000 minutes worth of 1 to 6 minute sketches, each written and illustrated by different people. So none of them are going to look the same or sound the same or be the same tone. This is kind of a departure, right? Because you knew what you were getting with Looney Tunes.
Yeah, I feel like they're going to get too artsy with this kind of thing, and they're going to try to put too much meaning behind what they're doing with the Looney Tunes. Just give me fucking Looney Tunes. I want to watch Looney Tunes. I don't want to watch a Looney Tunes fucking episode where the real deeper meaning is about fucking social injustice. That's what I feel like they're going to be doing with this kind of stuff.
100%.
Yeah, I think it allows for a different creative outlet. Think about how many Looney Tunes re-ups there have been, renditions, baby Looney
Tunes. Back in action. Space Jam.
Yeah, I mean, those were obviously great and awesome, but I think the amount of like bits and things that they could do was starting to run a little dry, and I think that they can, this could be a fresh start. I'm into it.
I'll give it a chance. I'll obviously start to watch it, but if it starts doing the typical bullshit we see with a lot of stuff we're getting on in television right now, then I'm going to be like, all right, peace. I want Looney Tunes. I don't want fucking...
I think they're going to try and grab the essence of Looney Tunes as being goofy and outlandish.
I think they're going to
be like trying to do that stupid Pixar intro that they'd had at The Incredibles.
Oh, I thought that was good. We'll talk about it later. I liked it.
What was darker, that intro or Hereditary?
It wasn't that dark.
It was fucking dark.
I think you were just like, oh my God.
I was super off-put by that.
That was where I totally turned it off. I was already weirded out.
We need to talk about that in spoilers.
We will.
Sure.
All right. In the same vein of bringing back childhood cartoons, Jordan Peele wants to direct a live-action Gargoyles movie.
Oh.
Gargoyles.
When's the last time you thought about Gargoyles?
Honestly.
The other day, to be honest, because...
Since I was 8, like, I was like, Gargoyles, sick. I used to love Gargoyles.
They had awesome action figures.
They did. They were so cool.
I mentioned the other day because I actually was thinking about it the other day. Funko Pop just released a line for Gargoyles.
Guerrilla marketing. Getting it out there.
And what would be better than a Gargoyles live action? I'll ask you guys.
Can you think Street Sharks?
Street Sharks.
I knew you were going to say Street Sharks,
man.
Street Sharks was incredible.
Oh, my God.
That's kind of in the same vein as, like, Battletoads that just got announced at E3.
What about Biker Mice from Mars?
I've never watched that.
I've seen that one.
They were all basically anthropomorphic, badass, jacked, early 90s cartoons. All of this came because Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Yeah. Everybody was like, we got to cash in on this shit. And then they did.
I really want to see Street Sharks again. Street Sharks was dope as fuck.
Wow. I'm just looking through the news and it's hitting me that all of this is reboots. We got trailers for The Grinch and Dumbo. Dumbo, I don't know what the fuck Dumbo's going to be. This is Tim Burton. Just trying to put a dark spin on Dumbo. I mean, the movie's already pretty dark.
Dumbo's just going to murder everyone.
Damn, that is going to be a dark movie. Doesn't his mom like get like taken away?
Yeah. And they had the super racist crows.
Yeah, dude.
The racist crows.
They were. Yeah, they were fucking caricatures.
I don't know. I saw that trailer and I didn't know what to think watching it, but...
Well, it's got a pretty good cast.
Yeah.
But I'm out on this. All right, final piece of news. And this... is an actual evil corporation. After the merger between AT&T and Time Warner was approved, Comcast calls up 21st Century Fox and offers $65 billion in
cash
to outbid Disney, who only bid $52 billion in stock.
How many briefcases of cash is that?
I don't know.
What if that's how they delivered it? Just like 522 briefcases of cash money, baby.
I'm just picturing them showing up like, you know, in movies when you see a little bag full of diamonds,
yeah,
they just show up with a fucking bags with dollar signs on them and just full of gigantic diamonds.
The head negotiator guy has one eye, of course, and a big scar going down his face.
100% bird on his shoulder.
It's just like we are here to make transaction.
It's Comcast.
Yeah, we're getting really close to evil conglomerate territory.
I think we're ready there, to be honest.
But now the latest rumor is, and just a rumor, obviously, is that Disney and Comcast would go in and split up some of the IP. I don't know what the fuck's going to happen, man. This is not good for the industry regardless. Yes, I wanted to see the X-Men in Marvel movies, but we're getting to a point where we're going to have 3 movie studios.
Scary.
I don't know how that's going to work out. We shall see.
It's going to work out poorly is how it's going to work out. You guys could...
I'm letting that sink in. What are the 3 movie studios?
It'll be Disney. Comcast, which owns Universal, and in this would own Fox, and Time Warner, I guess now is AT&T, which is Warner Brothers, which owns a shitload. There are going to be 3 movie studios left.
So I'm initially thinking of what are the opening logos going to be when movies start?
Skynet.
It's going to be a giant middle finger. Fuck you. You'll watch it.
Do you know what I mean, though?
It's going to be the guys.
The big WB. What's that going to be?
I fuck if I know.
It's going to be a, uh, co- uh, no, wait,
I think it's going to be a big middle finger, maybe in zoomed in asshole.
Or it should be the guys from South Park for that cable episode where they're just rubbing their titties. Just like, oh, yeah, you guys can't get any.
Oh, you don't have any other providers.
Fuck you, Comcast. This is why I started hating Chris Hardwick in the first place, is because he turned into a shill for Comcast. He claimed to be a nerd and pro-nerd, and Comcast stands for everything that is against nerds.
Like what?
Like free internet and open internet and fucking throttling back your internet and censoring things and fuck Comcast.
And internet.
I love when you rant.
I really thought you guys would have some thoughts on this, but I guess not.
No one likes evil conglomerates, man. That's why Monopoly is a staple in our gaming industry.
Wow, that's, I never thought of it that way, but the winner of that game is
goddamn Comcast.
An asshole.
Yeah. And that's why everyone always flips the board and is like, fuck this game. I'm not going to jail.
Let's go play Risk.
Exactly. World domination.
Fucking nerd. All right, guys. I think you know what time it is.
Best.
We the best!
Worst.
The worst! She's the worst person in the world. Huge skank. Terrible, but thank you.
I can't wait to unveil my shirt in our video that we're going to record later today. John Ralphio. It's a great shirt. It's probably the best shirt I've ever bought.
Is that what you're going
to
wear?
It's a banger.
100%. Nice. I think it ties in too well. Mark, who's your best man alive?
Gonna keep this real simple. Jared Leto. He's getting a solo Joker movie. No, that's not the reason I'm giving it to Jared Leto.
I was about to say, we talked about this last week and you were all butthurt.
I'm not giving it to Jared Leto for that
You're
reason.
You're wearing two different socks
I know.
Again.
I was waiting for
what
you to know.
What the fuck is wrong with you?
They're not just...
I'm gonna have a talk with Kelly and she's gonna start laying your socks out for you every day.
Do these kind of socks piss you off, dude? The ankleless
socks? No, I don't care about that. But why can't you put the right socks together?
Funny story about that. My cousin Pat, he was notorious for at every family party growing up when we were like 10 or 12 years old, he would always be missing a sock on his foot. He'd just have one sock.
What a great story.
He was notorious for that, though. Imagine your cousin just at every family party walking around just with one sock on. It's like, where the fuck did your sock go?
Well, he's probably like you, where he realized it bothers somebody and he just started doing it to piss him off.
Yeah, probably.
Or he just would always go to the back room, beat off, and then not have a sock anymore.
Wow, I'm talking about
that
my
took
cousin
a real weird turn.
Yeah, this is when he was 10 years old. I don't know when you started doing that, but holy shit. You're like, oh, I beat off for the first time when I was 6.
Some people blossom younger.
I saw a funny meme the other day.
God damn it. Just like, I never should have gone off on this tangent.
What do you think the first person that figured off what beating off was said, like, in that moment? Just like, guys, you got to check the shit out. Oh my god. Yeah, who do you
sound like? Rick James.
Oh.
Is it, do you Rick sound James, like Rick James bitch. When you come?
Oh, yeah. What the five fingers say to the face?
Right. Slap. Let's get back on track. I'm giving it to Jared
my
Leto.
My worst man alive is Mark because he can't get his socks right. Sorry, go ahead.
I'm going to give it to Jared Leto. Today is Saturday, June 16th. I know this episode is going to come out a couple days later, probably start of the week. But I saw 30 Seconds to Mars last night on Friday, and... That was my first 30 Seconds to Mars, and let me just say, he killed that show. I'm definitely going to go see them if they ever come back to Chicago, so I'm going to give it to him. And he was also wearing a super sick Gucci robe.
Jared Leto
amazing.
Is the lead, is like a, in that band?
Yeah, 30 Seconds to Mars, he's the lead singer.
Weird.
So he's like sponsored by Gucci or something, so
I have a legit question for you.
Go ahead.
If Jared Leto came up to you and said, Mark, fillet me, out of here, what would you say?
Course.
Especially if he was in his Dallas Buyers Club outfit.
Oh my god.
No, if he was in the weird Joker get up with the tattoos on his face. You fucking love Jared Leto.
He calls a shit ton of people up on stage throughout the concert. The last song, he called up about probably 100 people from the crowd. Kelly and I were trying to get picked, but he didn't let us come up there, and Kelly was pissed.
She's socks.
Like, Kelly's like, if you were wearing your Batman mask right now, you would 100% be up there.
The and one was, time you don't have it, you know?
The one time I'm not wearing my Batman mask. Fuck. But next time.
You're literally wearing your Batman mask right now.
Exactly. Where are the drugs going?
All right, Brick, who's your best man alive?
I am going to give it to your arch nemesis, Dave Portnoy, because he hilariously had this. He has the pizza review thing he puts up on Twitter and YouTube and Instagram. And he did a pizza review with the tag, with the cast of Tag, which is John Hamm, Jake Johnson, Jeremy Renner, Hannibal Buress, Ed Helms. And this girl just goes up and just goes, hey, I've seen you in the videos on Twitter. And Dave's like, yo, are you talking to me? She's like, yeah, you're the guy from the Twitter videos. And she's just standing next to five A-list celebrities, and the internet guy just like won. I thought that was hilarious.
It blows me away. One, because Jon Hamm is so handsome. Yeah. If you see Jon Hamm, you're like, oh, you're a fucking movie star,
yeah,
right?
You're somebody.
Jon Hamm's the man.
Also, who gives they're a shit? Endlessly talented, and Dave Portnoy is not.
This pisses you off so much.
I fucking hate him. He's the worst.
He's hilarious.
No, he's not.
He's very funny.
If he actually was funny, I wouldn't hate him.
He's very funny because he plays this overconfident. It's like, I think it's a character to be
No,
honest.
It's not. That's him.
It is. It's over the top. It's hilarious.
He is the prototypical Boston asshole.
Yeah, it's hilarious. He leaned into it, and I think it's amazing.
All right, whatever. My best man alive is much better than yours because it's not a man. I have a question for you, Mark.
What?
Is a raccoon a mammal?
Yes.
Okay, good. My best mammal alive is the raccoon that scaled the building in Minneapolis and became an overnight Twitter sensation. The pictures and videos of people like, okay, obviously you're looking at me like you didn't hear the story. So there was this raccoon that scaled like a 30-story building in Minneapolis. And I had no idea that raccoons could just climb up a brick wall like that. But
they got hands, man.
Apparently they have thumbs and shit. But basically what you're seeing is people in this office building, at their boring-ass day jobs, are looking out the window on the fucking 20th story and seeing a raccoon just chilling on the window ledge. Like, you know how when you go in a high-rise and you see a spider and you're at, like, the 40th floor?
Yeah.
How the fuck did that spider get there?
Long journey.
Well, they're called bridge
spiders. But imagine doing that and seeing a raccoon.
People love an excuse not to go back to work. I'm sure people...
Yo, there's a raccoon in the ledge.
For 2 hours, we're watching this raccoon just going nuts about it at work.
Which gave people hope.
Yeah.
That's what this raccoon stands for.
It's like, maybe hope. I can get out of work early today because this raccoon.
And that's why this raccoon is my best mammal alive.
Mammal.
They alive. Did actually catch it once it got to the roof. It got all the way to the fucking roof.
And they caught it?
Yeah. They put a trap up there.
You're going to jail.
The funny thing is, if this wasn't like a Twitter sensation, they 100% would have killed that raccoon. They would have trapped it and killed it. Instead, they had to show a video of them catching it and then releasing it into the wild.
You got Mark Wahlberg, just sniping it down.
Probably.
Let me see a raccoon over there. I gotta fucking kill it.
Another Boston asshole.
Best mammal alive.
All right, let's do Incredibles 2.
Let's do it.
Brick, you wanted us to cast a live action Incredibles for some reason. I assume that you have content here. Please go ahead.
I say we do, since Mark is just not included in this one because he just decided to not do it at all.
He was busy at a concert.
I can do it on
night.
The fly.
We'll do character by character, and I'll do mine, you do yours, and then we'll go to the list, and we'll see who, we'll let the people choose who had a better live action, who would they rather see in the live action.
My guess is that no one cares.
Yeah, well, maybe someone will answer. That's all we can ask for. I guess we'll start out with Mr. Incredible himself. I have Patrick Warburton.
You just...
How good would Putty be at playing Mr. Incredible?
I can't argue with this because he's big and he has a voice.
He'd have a great voice for it. And he just has that alpha male high school football kind of like...
I don't think he's beaten down enough. Like, right. Life hasn't beaten the shit out of him enough to be Mr. Incredible.
I want in on this. My Mr. Incredible will be, who's the guy that is Kane in the WWE?
I don't know, Kane.
Kane.
Okay, we'll just say Kane. Kane. He's actually like running for governor of some fucking...
It's like mayor of some city in Mississippi or some shit.
But Kane.
Why?
Okay, Mark's out.
Because Kane.
You lose immediately.
Yeah. No, I'm involved
We're
in
skipping
this.
Mark.
You,
We're
no,
skipping Mark.
No,
every time.
I'm going to win. Kane.
See, I went a different direction with this. I don't think he needs to look alpha. I obviously think he's more beaten down by life. Kevin James?
Kevin James was my second choice, honestly. If I didn't bring up Kevin James last week, I would have almost picked him.
I couldn't land on... I had a few. John Goodman, maybe.
Okay.
He's probably too old.
Yeah.
What about Jim Gaffigan?
Yes, I think Jim Gaffigan would have actually been a really good choice. Because he is his dad, he is like 12 children.
All he does is bitch about his kids, and that is Mr. Incredible in this movie.
That is. Wow. So Jim Gaffigan would have been a better choice than Kevin James, but you picked Kevin James. So,
all right. What about Elastigirl?
I have Natalie Portman, just because I think she kind of looks like her in the face.
Yeah.
And plus, Natalie Portman would be great. Just to have.
I do love Natalie Portman.
Who doesn't love Natalie Portman?
Only if she raps.
What do you got?
This is my weakest one. I could not pick anybody for this to save my life, but Patricia Heaton from The Wife from
Everybody
Loves
Raymond.
She's got that mom feel, the dark hair, the like the same haircut, kind of.
And she, elastic girl, so she can just like, she doesn't really need to be tall or.
Yeah.
She can just stretch out.
I worry that her butt isn't big enough.
You need a donk to play Elastigirl.
Thicker than a bowl of oatmeal. Patricia Heaton with Kim Kardashian's butt.
Okay, that's illegal. It's an illegal move in the game, so.
We didn't lay out rules. Whatever. Okay. Who's your Elastigirl? Oh, you already said. Mark, do you have one?
Mine would have to be.
Great. Moving on. Who's your Violet?
I think I want to do a younger Aubrey Plaza.
I don't know how that works, but okay.
She looks young enough, I think.
She looks young enough. And I think if we're the direction that I'm going to take this one, I think she would fit in with the comedy aspect of it.
What are you rewriting the whole movie?
No, but she wouldn't be as like polite. She'd be a little bitchier, I think.
Violet is very bitchy in these movies.
No, she was like nice and. Aubrey Plaza, that's my go-to. God.
Mine is Anya Taylor-Joy from Split.
Okay.
Dark hair, very creepy looking.
Okay.
You have no idea what I'm talking about.
Nope. I need to see Split. I heard that's actually an incredible movie.
It is pretty good.
Mine is Miley Cyrus.
You just said incredible again.
That's first time.
I'll have to check
We'll have to check the tape.
Why Miley Cyrus? Is it because she has gigantic teeth?
Yep.
That's a bad answer. Brick, who's your Dash?
Dash, I'm going with... Chase Vanderbleek. I'm gonna be honest. I'm going with an unnamed guy here because couldn't think of anybody for Dash.
Wow, cool. You lose. Mine is Josh Hutcherson from Hunger Games. Looks just like Dash,
and he's super short.
Yeah, he's a little too old, but I don't know any kid actors. Like if we watched Disney Channel, I'm sure we could rattle off 10 casting choices for each of these. But I don't know any young actors.
Yeah, that was a tough one. Except for
the kids from Stranger Things.
Yeah, and that's like too. Finn Wolfhard would have been.
Yeah, that's too easy.
I'm going to go with another musician. Ed Sheeran would be a good Dash.
Okay, no. kill yourself.
Who's your Jack-Jack?
Jack-Jack? CGI Jack-Jack.
No.
I CGI him in.
Jack-Jack is The Rock.
Okay.
100%. Think about it. He turns into that beast thing, and it's just The Rock.
Okay, so if he turns into the beast, one of his 17 abilities is turning into The Rock.
Yeah.
All right.
As he gets older, he doesn't turn into that monster anymore. He just turns into Dwayne The Rock Johnson.
That would be because he learns to morph properly. That would actually be kind of funny.
The final form of his best version is The Rock.
Exactly.
All right. Who else you got?
Frozone.
This is just Samuel L. Jackson.
No.
Yes.
Dave Chappelle would have played this perfectly. I almost said incredible again. He would have played it perfectly. He's hilarious. He would have had great chemistry with Putty, aka Patrick Warburton. That'd have been amazing. Go ahead. Who do you got?
Samuel L. Jackson.
Yeah. He's too old.
No, he's not.
Yes, he is.
He's supposed to be old.
No, he's like a middle-aged, like 40-year-old man. Look at Frozone and look at Dave Chappelle.
First of all,
they look exactly like.
No one has any idea how old Samuel L. Jackson is because he's looked the same for the last 30 years.
An ageless wonder.
He could easily do this, and you can't separate the voice from Samuel L. Jackson. He's the recognizable one.
You can't separate.
Dave Chappelle has a recognizable voice.
Yes, but what I mean is,
it's stuck with him.
Yes,
whatever. Dave Chappelle would be funnier. Void? Do we go there?
Nobody knows who that is.
Okay. Edna.
So this character is based on Linda Hunt. Like if you look at a picture of Linda Hunt, it is Edna Mode, but that's not my choice.
Okay.
My choice, since her eyes are super far apart, is Uma Thurman.
I like it. Okay. Based off of her eyes.
Yeah.
Mine was Ken Jeong, because I think he'd have the accent down perfectly. Just he's the same character from what he is in the Hangover.
Yeah.
Well, would be a woman.
Yeah, that would be hard to pull off, but I'm sure he's down for it. I've seen his tiny wiener before.
Yeah, you have?
Yeah. In The Hangover.
Oh, yeah. Three
times.
Hilarious.
How could that image leave your brain?
Okay.
What's up, gay boy? What's happening?
You do a pretty good impression of that one. All right. Just for these, we won't do any more. We'll just end it there. But I had Winston Dever. How do you say that guy's name?
Dever.
Winston Dever. He looked just like John Stewart. Did he not?
Not really.
I think he looked exactly like John Stewart. And then the Evelyn Dever, Brooke Langton, aka the cheerleader from The Replacements. She had that raspy voice. Man,
everybody knows who that is.
Everybody knows who that is. Of course.
Yeah, you should just stick to the main cast.
You should have participated, and then you could have a say in it.
I did participate.
No, not like...
My answers were valid.
Great. Incredibles 2. Like I said, we waited 14 years for Pixar to make this fucking sequel. Currently at 94% on Rotten Tomatoes from both fans and critics. So it's very rare that people agree that to that level, but I think that this is pretty spot on. Written and directed by Brad Bird, who you would recognize from writing and directing The Iron Giant, Ratatouille, and he also did Tomorrowland, which was a massive flop.
Did you see that movie?
No.
I heard it wasn't that bad.
All I know is that it lost Disney a shitload of money.
Oh, yeah. Oh, God forbid.
Yeah, I know. Now they can only bid $52 billion.
No. Stock options.
Did you know that he's also the voice of Edna Mode?
I looked into that. That's actually hilarious.
I didn't know that.
I thought that would just be like a little old woman. But no, that's Brad Bird. Impressive.
Very impressive, because she is a very iconic voice.
So I want to ask, when's the last time either of you saw Incredibles?
Last weekend.
Ago. You watched it for the first time last weekend, didn't you?
Yeah, I loved it, too.
So we're the idiots for not playing Risk, but you waited 14 years to see The Incredibles.
No, what happened was I saw like the very end of The Incredibles, and I was like, oh, yeah, I've seen The Incredibles before, and I'd never really went back to it. And then it was just on TV, and I was like, I actually don't think I've seen this movie before. And then I loved it, and I was like, oh, sick, The Incredibles is amazing.
That's even worse.
Maybe I just didn't remember, you know? I don't know.
I played Risk, and I just didn't remember because it sucked.
That goes against the point that I just made, actually.
So let's talk about the actual movie. What did you guys think about the animation, the cinematography, the action?
I thought it was next level. Like, they waited 14 years after seeing the first movie, and I was like, oh, this is like pretty good animation for 14 years ago. And then when I saw it in IMAX the other day, I was like, some of these scenes seem real. Like, it is live action. Like, some of the CGI was fantastic. And I think the angles that they took and the perspectives that they took with like the wide shots and showing, like, for example, the first scene in the movie is shot from the boyfriend's point of view, Violet's boyfriend, and just taking it from a civilian's point of view and seeing the underminer from a different angle than from the hero's perspective was just like awesome.
I think you made a good point there, as much as I hate to say it. The action felt realer than it should have.
Agreed.
There's a scene in particular where Elastigirl is fighting the villain in his quote-unquote lair, and you can feel the struggle that's happening. It's very weird and hard to explain, but you can you feel tired watching it.
It's a different vibe than most animated movies I've seen.
I've never seen an animated film that made me feel the way that I did watching this.
It was next level.
Quickly, my opinion is I didn't. What?
Yeah. Don't need to tell me what you. Just say your fucking opinion.
So I didn't even realize it. Okay, now I lost my train of thought. Thank you.
I'm sorry, dude. It just, you wrote some stuff and you even wrote it into your script.
I know.
What the fuck, man? Everybody knows it's your opinion. You're literally saying it.
All right.
So here's what I'm thinking.
I just want to share my opinion on this.
Let me throw in my 2 cents.
Can I go? Can I give my opinion? Go ahead. All right. All these Pixar movies in the last 8 years, it was hard for me to really understand the potential.
This is what happens, dude.
I can't fucking help it,
when
man.
You just don't let, when you just won't cut the fucking first thing I said, and now you just make me lose my whole train of thought.
Let me begin with my train of thought. Withhold it right there, you fucking idiot. Don't say that. You can't just cut that out and post.
I just want to say that I'm going to say that I said some stuff.
Yeah, I'm kind of blown that they're just able to continue progressing what they can do with all the CGI and all these Pixar films. Over the last 8 years, all these Pixar films, I really didn't quite understand the full potential they had with expanding all the angles and all of the effects they can be using with CGI. I just thought it was just going to be your basic Pixar type movie. And I was just blown away by all the things they were really able to do with the CGI and the animation throughout this whole movie.
It's like going from Xbox to a PC, just like the graphics have just like gone through the roof.
But at what point are we just satisfied? Like,
never.
Why does it have to be better than this?
Because technology's,
I don't even understand there. How it could be better than this.
They're basically making real people out of nothing. Like,
there are some shots going around the internet, you zoom in really close and you see the detail in Mr. Incredible's shirt. Why
nobody
not? Needs to see that.
Well, you need to evolve, because I went back and looked back at the one that was in 14 years ago, and the graphics looked good, but there was a lot of details that made it look fake, and they brought the realism in The Incredibles 2. That's how much they've advanced, is they're making it more realistic.
Especially when you look at Elastigirl and how realistic her body shape is. It's a cartoon.
They do a brilliant job of playing to that as well. Like, they have like the over exaggerated bodies and stuff like that, but they also have, like, for example, they, when they're watching TV in the living room, they had a cartoon on the TV and it made the realism pop, so to say.
I would just love to sit down and talk to someone at Pixar Animation, somebody that works on these scenes.
It's someone that hasn't slept in 8 days.
I want to just ask them, how much time does it take to, let's say, make a 5-second scene in these Pixar films?
That's a great question.
14 years.
Because, to your point, the amount of detail they put into everything they do with these movies is ridiculous.
I don't know why I'm arguing against it getting better. I don't know. At what point is it just good enough?
I don't think it
never will
be.
It's an ever expanding landscape. That's why VR is a thing. It's like, if you have these systems built in place where you can make Mr. Incredible and then you can go in and fine tune him and make him look more realistic, why would you not?
It only gets
easier.
I don't look at it that way. I think what they're doing with the shots is more of an example of the potential they have and how they're progressing with this. I don't think necessarily being able to see Mr. Incredible's nose hairs from an animation side is the point we should be trying to make here. I think what was great with this movie is those scenes where with the Underminer, they were underground in a scene, and just all the rubble coming down,
the
dust and everything like that.
The textures.
And then the fighting scenes, the movements of these Pixar characters. You don't get that with a lot of other Pixar movies because they're happy-go-lucky, just basic movements in a lot of them. But
there are some dark tones in these movies, though.
Yeah.
I'm thinking back to the first one when they just rattle off a list of dead superheroes.
Yeah, yeah.
Also, there was a scene where Elastigirl pulls Mr. Incredible back in. Like, you know they're going to go, fuck. Like, he starts working out again in the first one. You know what I'm talking about. He starts, like, he gets a new job and he's all happy and shit, starts working out. He's leaving. He walks out the door. She grabs him, pulls him back inside. They're fucking.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
They're making another little jack-jack.
For sure.
Got to have the adult-themed undertones, obviously.
I don't think that was really necessary.
Why not?
I don't know.
Character.
She thought he was cheating on her in the first one.
That's true.
Darkman. All right. What did you guys think of the score?
I can't really comment on
it. Yeah, it's forgettable.
Exactly. And that's kind of a problem, right? Because Pixar has recognizable great score. I mean, you think about the song from Up. Mm-hmm. I could hear it and immediately know, oh, yeah, that's from Up. This one has a theme song, but I don't feel like they used it to the top of its potential.
Agree.
Yeah.
The fact that you don't notice it is not good.
That's a good point. I think I was too stunned with the visuals, to be honest. I was like, what is this? Is real.
All right. Well, let's keep going down that path. We got some new characters, some new supers. What did you think of the character design?
I thought Screenslaver, I thought he was pretty creepy looking. One thing they did well was his voice was pretty creepy. I liked they were outlandish a little bit. I didn't like one of the superheroes particularly. That kind of pissed me off, actually.
Oh, you mean your twin?
Yeah. My twin sister. Brick, because she's a girl. Literally hilarious.
The first time I saw that character, I was like, that's a dude.
Same. I was like, they really overdid it with the pectoral muscles. And then I was like, oh.
Nope, those are tits.
I looked it up. She just has bombs. Like, what the hell?
I thought that the character design was super original. You have to think that the first Incredibles movie came out in 2004. Before we had a Marvel Cinematic Universe, before we had the Dark Knight trilogy, they were doing this before all of that. They had all of these original ideas. And even in this, in the midst of saturation of superhero movies, they came up with some pretty original characters. The fucking old dude that spits out lava, that was hilarious.
Acid reflux or superpower.
I mean, that was a terrible joke.
You tell me. It's an old person joke. It just fit his personality perfectly. It's
exactly.
Like,
and that's something you don't see in other superhero movies is old superheroes.
Very true.
All the one-off superheroes that are in Incredibles 2, the great thing they did with them is there was never a point throughout the movie where I was like, oh, wait, what's their superpower? I knew right off the bat they had all their unique type aspects to what their superpowers were. I remembered them throughout the whole movie. There wasn't a time in the movie where one of these one-off characters came into play and I was like, wait, what superpower do they have? There was never that moment, which is great, and it tells you so much about how they're really able to convey and be unique with the superpowers they're giving to all of these other characters throughout the movie.
They kept it simple, which is, I think, brilliant in its own way, is the simplicity behind it. Like, all the moves with Elastigirl, they just focused on her one ability. And they did the same thing with Mr. Incredible. They focused on his one ability and how he utilizes it in combat. It's just, they don't have all these extra additional gadgets or anything like that, that they're messing with, like in the Marvel universe and stuff like that. It's just like they kept it simple.
Yeah, but they also didn't keep it simple, because if all their powers were simple, it wouldn't be funny and wouldn't be as enjoyable. Like when Smithers mentioned the old guy that burps up lava or whatever, that's unique, that's funny. Yeah. We have another guy, not going to get too far into spoilers, that his only power is that he can crush things. And there's
just so hilarious.
There's a hilarious joke.
One of the best lines from the movie.
One of the best lines.
I think that was voiced by Phil Lamar, by the way.
Was he in?
John Stewart, Green Lantern. Yeah. He's one of the biggest voice actors. Doesn't matter. They brought in some original ways for Elastigirl to use her powers. When she has the motorcycle, which is something we didn't see in the first one, that was great.
Agreed. And that's where they kept it simple, but like they expanded a lot on like how she uses her abilities.
Except for with Jack-Jack, but that's another story.
Yes.
Yeah, just seeing her, seeing them come up with new ways for her to use her powers was really interesting.
Same.
Which leads me into the story. This is The Watchmen for kids, right? Who watches The Watchmen?
To some extent.
So what do you guys think about the overall story then?
I loved the disjunction of roles between Mr. Incredible and Miss and Elastigirl. Like, he wants to be out there and be a superhero, and he can't because it's illegal. And if there's just like this opportunity for them to make it not illegal, and he has to take the back seat, and she doesn't want to be out there because she just wants to be like a helicopter parent and just like make sure her kids are all doing well. But she kind of goes out there and realizes that she is a person too. I just like the disjunction of roles that they had. So I like the
Mark's favorite thing, using pop culture to crush gender stereotypes.
Yeah, exactly. My favorite.
There were a couple of points in there when Elastigirl was talking with Dever's sister, Evelyn Dever, which, by the way, Evelyn Dever, Evil Endeavor.
Nice. That's fine. I didn't catch that.
There's a part where they're talking like, oh, you need a big, strong man. Like, come on. It's obvious you don't need the exposition for that. I get
it. It's a kid's movie.
I don't know.
You got to have some layups.
No, this movie is for me. I waited 15 fucking years for this movie. It's for me.
It's not a kid's movie. It's our movie. Yeah.
I just talked about Elastigirl fucking Mr. Incredible, okay?
Yeah.
It's not a kid's movie.
It's not like they showed full penetration or anything. They're just like, oh, what's up? You got it. Sweet arms.
I'd watch it.
Wait, what?
It's probably out there.
Last girl, thick as fuck. Mark, what did you think about the character development?
The character development was fine. I just had some issues with some other things. The villain didn't really do it for me as much as it did in the first one. The stakes, I don't think, were as high as they were in the first one. And that was probably my one issue. I just really didn't enjoy the villain as much. And care as much about this villain.
The motivation didn't make any sense. Yeah.
The thing I really loved about the first one is not until the ending of this installment of Incredibles do you really get to see the family as one. And that was the whole point of the first one, is they were together through thick and thin, I guess, and they were just building their relationship as Team Incredible. And that's what I love to see in the first one. This one, there was a lot of jumping around between the characters and scenes. There were scenes where we got to look at what Elastigirl was doing in the city to fight crime, but then it would jump back to Mr. Incredible taking care of the kids, which is great. A lot of the story was built off of that dynamic, but at the same time, I just missed the synergy of the family because I feel like it was a little bit lost throughout the movie because they were jumping around to all the different characters doing different things throughout it.
But if you leave them together, I feel like the threat is not as looming. If they're together, they're too strong. So I think you have to split them up. Otherwise, you don't feel like there are stakes.
Yeah, that's true, I guess, too.
All right, I got one other thing before we get into spoilers. Dash sucks. His character sucks. The kid sucks.
Why don't you like him?
He's a little asshole.
I think he's hilarious.
When he pulls out the remote and he's about to blow up a room full of people, I'm like, what are you doing? You're going to shoot rockets in a fucking room full of people, you asshole. Also, how did they know to name him Dash? Dashiell is his full name. How do they know to name him Dash if he didn't have his powers when he was a baby?
True.
It was ruined in the cosmic stars.
Movie's ruined.
Know what else was kind of a downer? They make a mention that as a baby, they can have a lot of different superpowers, and it's not until, I guess, they grow up where they'll have one defined superpower. That kind of was a bummer for me because I wanted Jack-Jack to have all those powers growing up, and I think that'd be a great spin-off movie to have. Him growing up, too, with all those powers and just being a fucking ruling the whole world.
A Jack-Jack coming-of-age tale.
Yeah.
Incredibles 3 is going to be Jack-Jack as like a six-year-old, and the rest of the family has to decide whether they launch him into space because he's become a threat to humanity,
yeah,
or they just take over the world with him.
I like it.
Adult movies. This is not for kids. All right, let's rate this so we can get into spoilers.
I think the visuals on this were incredible.
Ugh, you wanted to say incredible so bad.
That's why I leaned into it.
He's been saying it all morning.
I'm going to go with...
All right, I'm going to give this an 8.5.
I'm giving it a 9.
I'm going to give it a 8.
Ooh, Mark.
It's on my Pixar scale. I wouldn't put it probably in my top 5. So
what is it on the Fast and Furious scale?
12.
It's about a 3.
Maybe a 4, 4.5.
All right, spoilers from this point forward. I will mark this in the show notes. If you haven't seen it yet, go see it. But make sure you stick around afterwards because we're going to talk about some of our weekly recommendations. All right.
Who's your favorite new character you get in this movie? Mine's the Crusher.
I think it has to be the Crusher just because he has hilarious lines.
You cannot uncrush. You cannot uncrush.
How would you like it if someone told you to unpunch? So stupid, but hilarious. I loved the new characters. They could make spinoffs for this and I'd watch them.
Yeah, 100%.
Same.
What did you think about Screenslaver and the reveal that it is Evelyn Dever?
Very predictable.
I think it would have been more predictable if it was him and not William. The sister.
Yeah.
That was the only unpredictable part. I thought initially they were working together.
Same.
Yeah.
I was a little bit blown that he had nothing no idea what was going on.
That's
her
the twist.
Actions don't make any fucking sense because she's been helping him for all of this time. And now she's going to go. Like, why didn't you just not help him? Then he's not a billionaire that's going on this big PR crusade for superheroes.
Well, she wanted to put him in jail or put him down forever, right? That was her goal.
They were already illegal.
Yeah, stupid.
I was hoping that one of you would be able to defend that, but I just think it doesn't make sense.
Yeah.
Was it obvious once she starts talking about being the underappreciated one?
At the beginning, in the first act? Kind of, or maybe it was the second.
I think it's about the second act where she starts talking about to Elastigirl about how, like, you know, I'm the brains behind this and I don't really get the appreciation. Yeah, of course you're going to be the bad guy. Yeah.
Well, that's definitely where they jumped into. That's why I thought it was going to be William and her. I didn't think it was going to be just her.
Okay. I want you guys to name one fight in a superhero movie that was better than Jack-Jack versus the Raccoon.
Oh, that's a tough question.
That was my favorite part of this entire movie.
Yeah, it was.
Say it.
It was incredible.
Incredible. Incredible.
That was another example of, this one's a little funnier than Elastigirl versus Screenslaver.
Of course.
You still kind of feel like there's an actual battle going on you don't get with cartoons.
I think the best part about that whole thing was the reaction of Mr. Incredible, because he was sleeping and then he was just like wakes up and to find his baby fighting a raccoon. Just like, that's like a worst case scenario as a dad. Just like, fuck.
Good thing Jack-Jack can't get rabies because he's literally indestructible.
He's amazing.
He has every power. If you can be one superhero, it's Jack-Jack because he can do fucking everything.
Hell
Mark
yeah.
Mark still would pick Batman, but.
Yeah. How many people do you think were having seizures in that one scene? When I'm thinking visuals and the shit that they went over the top with, and I was blown away by seeing, what instantly came to my mind was the scene with Screenslaver when they're in his little lair fighting, and
that was
he turns on the lights, the strobe type hypnosis lights or whatever you want to call it. That shit they did, from just a Pixar standpoint, I was blown away that they could do that kind of stuff. And I was looking at it just in awe.
And I think they had to have that because she's literally fighting with her eyes closed.
Yeah.
Yeah. She should have just blew up like a balloon and just covered the whole thing with her face on the inside.
You should be a superhero.
Fucking right. I kind of am, goddammit.
We had to talk about Jack-Jack, though. He's going to be a problem. You got to launch that baby in space.
But back to my point, when he grows up, is he going to have all those powers?
I don't know, because Edna talks about like how he's a special case, and I don't know.
Well, they said Dash had no powers, right? And then
No, he has the power to suck. Because he fucking sucks.
He had no powers and then he turned out to be really fast. He didn't have like additional powers, right?
I don't think he did. I don't know. I'd have to go back and rewatch this. But either way, this baby's going to be a fucking problem. He already is a problem. So imagine when he gets to be a 2-year-old and he's teething.
The terrible
and he just
twos.
Lights the city of fucking New York on fire.
Imagine that little beast mode and terrible at the terrible twos. When the cookies.
He just shows up to an Oreo factory and kills everyone.
He just kills everybody in the Girl Scouts. Like the Girl Scout Brigade is dead.
God.
I think Edna and Jack-Jack, I would say, have my favorite chemistry between
would you say
two
that,
characters.
Mark? Would yeah. you say that?
Yeah. Hilarious. They had great chemistry, and I wanted to see more of that.
I'm glad they brought Edna back in for this. She's one of the best parts of the
you
first one.
She's
absolutely
great. she gets so pissed off when she finds out that someone else made the suit.
Yeah.
Hilarious.
It's amazing.
Is there anything else you guys wanted to talk about?
I don't think so. It's just like, go see it. It's honestly incredible. Oh,
okay. So short spoilers this week, but that's good. Wait, go see this. It's worth absolutely seeing in IMAX.
100%. Also, we never talked about that baby eating lady.
Oh, yeah. Fuck. Let's talk about the short film.
Wow. So if you're into really dark horror movies, make sure you show up for the previews for this movie, because there's a short film. Pixar does all of these. You know, they did the Frozen short before Coco and all that other shit. This was fucking weird.
I don't think it was that weird.
This was disturbing.
A little old Asian woman makes bao, and one of them turns into a child, and she eventually eats it. How is that not fucked up?
I think the worst part about it, like, she made this bowl, she ate 12 of them, and then the last one turns into a little person.
Has she just been eating little bao people?
Exactly. She wasn't worried about it at all, that she just ate 11 of her family, 11 bao babies. She
that reminds like, me of that episode of Futurama where they eat the poplars. If you guys don't watch Futurama.
I've seen that. Yeah. And they turn out to be...
When they get older, they turn into actual living beings.
Yeah, that's all
fucked up.
You guys are taking it way too literal. I enjoyed that short film.
Yeah, because you love dark stuff.
And it was actually the first short film actually done by a woman.
It was the darkest thing I've seen since Hereditary.
You know what? You just have to really understand the true meaning behind it. Bao, yes, it's a steamed bun, but it was also something she created in her son. Her son was Bao, but
her son was the Bao. You guys got recommendations for the week?
My recommendations would be...
Dude, just spit it out. All right? You don't need to say what your recommendation is going to be. Just say it.
I was announcing that I was starting first.
How do you like it?
I was announcing that I was starting first.
I'm not the one that said it.
You don't need to tell me you're not the one that said it when you didn't say it. All right, Smithers, let's
look at this guy trying to bail himself out.
So my recommendation is,
dude,
anything at E3, if you're going to check out any game, check out Cyberpunk 2077, Last of Us 2, or that Spider-Man trailer looked phenomenal.
We have to do something to get us a PS4. Just so I can play Spider-Man.
I have a PS4, so.
Can you go on Craigslist and rent a PS4 from someone for...
If I have a friend that has a PS4, I would swap them my Xbox for like a month. Just so I can play Spider-Man.
Yeah.
Spider-Man's, it's going to be so awesome.
I've been catching up on Silicon Valley. Mark, you've been hammering at me to watch this forever. I'm almost through the fourth season. What's Ehrlich's name, the actor?
Bachman. T.J. Miller.
So I'm at the point where T.J. Miller kind of is taken off now.
Mm-hmm.
Was that his choice, or was this after he started being a shitbag and they wrote him out of the show?
They wrote him out of the show.
Okay. Yeah, so that's where I am. It's really good.
So funny.
It's hard to watch sometimes. You get that awkwardness by association.
Secondhand embarrassment.
Yeah, I can't. That makes me a little uncomfortable, but it's funny enough that I stay with it.
Do you like Guilfoyle?
I love Guilfoyle.
You are Guilfoyle, you fucking death fuck.
What?
Guilfoyle's comments on anything and everything are the best.
He is a great dynamic with Kumail.
He's a great dynamic with everyone he associates with in that fucking
He told
series.
Richard to chortle his balls.
You can chortle my balls.
That's brilliant. I'm sorry.
Richard's hilarious with his awkwardness too. When he has to do this, he has to do like speeches and shit. He just like chokes up and freaks out.
He's a pretty good actor. And obviously it landed him some Verizon commercials and shit. But yeah, I'd like to see him in more stuff. My other recommendation is I've been catching up on some comic books, actually, which is how this podcast started in the first place. But Charles Soule's run on Daredevil, which I've talked about in the past, is brilliant. He introduced a new villain called Muse that shows up in the beginning of this run and also later on. And it's twisted and dark and really fucked up. And it's great.
Were you amused? Ugh.
Also, Charles Soule is an attorney as well as a comic book writer. So Daredevil obviously is an attorney with his daytime persona of Matt Murdock. He does an excellent job of writing these court scenes and, arguments between attorneys, etc. Just because probably he has that experience. But if you're into comic books, definitely check this out. It's awesome.
All right. I'm going to do a comic also for my recommendation. Go check out Dark Knight's Metal. It just wrapped up a little while ago, but they just released the graphic novel for it. So it's an easy buy. You get one novel, you read the whole thing. It's fucking awesome. If you're into comic books or not into comic books, just read this.
Did Tom King write that?
Scott Snyder wrote it. Greg Capullo did most of the art in it. And then you also have cover variants from people like Jim Lee and all that. So it's
you fucking love
awesome
Jim Lee.
Art.
All right, for next week, we want to hear your submissions for the worst ideas that science has had in movies, and we'll be reviewing Jurassic World, Fallen Kingdom.
There you go.
I always want to call it Jurassic Park.
Because super not excited Park. To go see that movie, by the way, but okay.
Maybe it'll surprise us. I always like not looking forward to a movie and then it being just okay because it'll blow me away.
Hopefully we'll get a dinosaur riding down the side of a volcano, but that's yet to be seen.
So anyways, you can find us on social media at the ChumpCast, or you can call and text us at 847-920-6107.
Chumps on, motherfucker!